Welcome to Bible Believers Fellowship and this study of Mark chapter 3 verses 20 through 27 titled Jesus versus Friend and Foe. That may sound like a strange title, but have you ever felt like some of your closest loved ones were not supportive of your efforts to serve God? Well, Jesus went through that same thing, and we will examine such an incident in this study of Mark chapter 3 verses 20 through 27 titled Jesus versus Friend and Foe.
You might think that's a strange title to give this passage, but you'll see when we get in there why. Jesus versus friend and foe. You'll see that right off. But we begin in verse 20. Let's go ahead and read that together. And the multitude cometh together again, so that they could not so much as eat bread. After what we've read in the previous verses, Jesus comes together, and there's such a crowd. Jesus brings a crowd that is so heavy that they couldn't even eat. That'd be a nice problem to have here. We've not run into that, but we have plenty of room to eat, usually, every service. But you remember the last study, we saw that Jesus chose his 12 apostles, and he entered into a house. But the house then became so packed that they couldn't even pass around food. And I've been in those situations before, but it's rarely for the right reason. And when you see a packed house like that, where it's so crowded you can't really move, a lot of times there's something just kind of a show going on. And when it comes down to the show being over and the truly hungry believer or the true seeker is the only one left, and all the other people kind of disperse. And you're going to see that with Jesus. But in this case, he's in this house, and so his friends decide to help out. Read that with me in verse 21. And when his friends heard of it, they went out to lay hold on him, for they said he is beside himself. So Jesus isn't doing anything crazy, but it just kind of got crazy because people were hearing these stories, hearing these reports of what he was doing, and that they were already saying this might be the one, this might be the Messiah. They were debating over whether he's Elijah or the one to come, you know, the Messiah. And his friends come along, and you notice that they basically are saying that Jesus has lost his mind. Why? Well, they knew him. And he was just a kid raised by Joseph and Mary in Nazareth of Galilee. He was a carpenter's son. There's other places where you say, we know this guy. Isn't he the carpenter's son? And everybody's saying he's the Messiah? Why? Because they had this vision of the Messiah that was not based on clear understanding of Scripture. And when Jesus came along, and he was meek and lowly, he was born in a manger, he was raised just like any other Jewish child, that didn't fit their preconceived idea about what the Messiah would look like and what it would look like when he came. And so when he's doing all this and the whole world's kind of gone, in that part of the world has gone crazy over Jesus, his friends step in and they basically say, you know, he's beside himself. And that's where you get this kind of saying that with friends like these, Jesus didn't need enemies. If you're trying to do something for the Lord and your own friends and family are accusing you of being crazy and losing your mind, then Satan doesn't even need to raise up enemies to attack your ministry. And that's what's happened here with Jesus. You could call these folks best friend enemies. Folks, I just pretty sure all of us have them. If you step out to do something for the Lord, your best friends can be your worst enemies. Why? Because they know you. And they know you're just human. And they're thinking on a human level, God's not going to use you to do that. That's just way above your abilities or whatever. Why? Because they've been with you. They've seen you fall flat on your face. They've heard you say stupid things. They've been with you when you're just goofy and laughing hysterically over nothing. You're just too normal. And so your best friends can be your worst enemies. And as I said there at the bottom of the note, we could tell of innumerable stories of loved ones working against the ministry. In my 20-some years of ministry, some of the greatest hindrances I've had to overcome are close relatives and friends. And go back to the early 90s when I first announced my call into the ministry. There were people who basically said, there's no way. And, you know, just a few years before that, I was a totally different person. But that's the point. I was a totally different person. I became a born-again Christian. Everything changes. And second thing, it's not about me. It's not about you. When God calls you to do something, it's not about you, because when He calls you, He empowers you. And that's what your friends and relatives don't take into account when they hinder you like that. They're not taking into account the fact that, yeah, you may be a klutz, you may be forgetful, you may have tried 1,000 things before and failed. But what they forget is that in this instance, if God is calling you, He's going to empower you. And that's because so many of our friends and relatives, just like us, were just as guilty of thinking too often in the flesh and not in the spirit. Jesus' friends were thinking in the flesh. So as Jesus is your example, if you serve the Lord, you must beware of friendly fire. If any of you know anything about war, you know that we've lost some of our best and brightest soldiers being shot by our own people. Can you say Stonewall Jackson? Yes, I was with the South in that war. but whether you think the North or the South was right in that war, he's a story of friendly fire taking out somebody who was... He was just, General Lee basically said when they shot Stonewall, they took his right arm from him. And that was friendly fire. He was out on a scouting mission, and he was just trotting back to the camp, and one of the people guarding the camp thought he was enemy and shot him. It was a Confederate soldier. War is filled with that. Being a soldier right now in the American military is a death wish. If you go look at the Iraq War, the first Iraq War, I can't always get... was that Desert Storm?
Desert Shield.
Desert Shield was the first one. 600,000 soldiers went in there to fight. 200,000 are dying because of our military using depleted uranium weapons. We killed our own soldiers. The Iraqi military couldn't hardly kill our soldiers. They were just by the hundreds giving up. What they don't tell you is because they saw the weapons being used, and they realized that even if they survived, they were going to die. The news won't tell you that. Out of 600,000 of our soldiers, 200,000 are dying, and the American military killed them. That's friendly fire. And just as it is in the military today, the same thing went on the second time in Iraq, the same thing's going on in Afghanistan right now. And the ones they didn't kill with depleted uranium, they killed with the anthrax vaccine. And I can take you down to Southern Ohio and show you examples of men who are dying from both in Southern Ohio. Friendly fire. And when you're fighting a war, you can just about count on being killed by friendly fire as surely as you can being killed by the enemy. Talk to the men in Vietnam and how many of them got the Agent Orange and came back, some of them crazy, the other one dying of cancer. How many of our own men were killed by us spraying Agent Orange? What was the, I always forget, the burnt earth?
Scorched earth.
Napalm. How many of our own men died being bombed by napalm? Friendly fire. Same thing's true in the spiritual war, folks. Right now, I get more email, phone calls, and letters attacking me from professing Christians than I do from anybody. They're standing there with a Vatican Bible in their hands, attacking my King James Version. Or they'll stand there with a Bible in their hands, attacking me for taking a stand against this whole addiction to sodomy that we're seeing in our day and age. People say, why do you preach so much on sodomy? Because it's in my face every day. Amen. I don't have adulterers lining up at the door demanding their rights. I don't have thieves lining up at the door demanding their rights. But I do have sodomites lining up and demanding I stop preaching against their sin. That's why I mention it more often. And the people who write me and email me, professing Christians. Friendly fire, so to speak. And that's what Jesus faced. Here's some motivation. I just want to mention this. If you say you feel God is calling you to the ministry, if you come to me and tell me that, first of all, don't ask for my permission. I don't give permission. That's not my place. People go to their pastors and ask for permission. Do you think I could? Don't ask for permission. Annie doesn't come and say, could I? She says, Lee and I feel led to do this. I say, I'll make sure and let you inform everybody what you're doing next Sunday. Now, if you come to me and tell me that God has called you to be a bouncer at a strip bar, don't expect my... that happened. I mean, that happened. Yeah, Thomas, I'm glad to see you've gotten past that. You wouldn't believe some of the ministries that people come up with. But if it's a biblical ministry, and that's the only reason anybody should ever confront you, is if you're going against Scripture.
Amen, brother.
If something you're doing is not biblical, then no. I'm not going to support that. But any biblical ministry, you don't ask for permission from me or anybody else. It's God calling you. And so you come to me, but you go to your friends and relatives, especially when you first either become a Christian or first get on fire for the Lord, and then you go tell people what you're going to do. It's kind of a shell-shocking experience because you get these kind of remarks. You know what? You need to just calm down. You're embarrassing us and yourself. You know, we've seen this out of you before. Or something like that. That's the kind of thing you'll hear. Another thing you'll hear is, you know what? That's just too dangerous. It's life-threatening. You going down there to that mission, that's in a dangerous area. The cost is too great. I need $10,000. You know what? Someone says that. You know, that just cost me. Listen, I'm not asking you for the money. So you don't have to worry about anything. I've asked my Father. And if He wants me to go, He'll give me the money. Amen, Lee? Amen. You're endangering. This is one I personally heard. I've been told because of the way I preach, I'm endangering my family. They'll find out where you live. And they'll get your wife and your kids. They'll steal your puppies. Well, that's the point. Yeah, all these to an extent, you are an embarrassment in a worldly sense. It can be too dangerous for you, but it could also endanger your family. Those are all facts. They may be true. But where in the Bible did Jesus the apostles ever say, I'm not going to do it because it's going to endanger my life and my family. It's going to cost too much. You see, what I'm saying is they're not illegitimate, reasonable things in a worldly sense, but in a spiritual sense is where you go, here's a good one though. You're breaking the law. Mike Kaler goes over to Turkey and hands out gospel tracts. You're violating international law. I rebuke you. And then you say, well, there's that Bible verse in Acts where Peter says, should we obey God or man? When man's law goes against God's law, that's why I don't tell anybody. I'm going to bring this up because we're going to be getting our concealed carry permit. Sandy and I have talked about this. There's really not a legal, technical need for that. The Second Amendment says you have a right to carry and your weapons. We've just had our country taken over by a bunch of socialist communist pigs who have then turned the Bill of Rights on its head. See, the Declaration of Independence says we have inalienable rights that are granted by our Creator. The government doesn't have the right to tell me I can't carry a weapon. Because that's a human right. That's why it's in the Bill of Rights. The Bill of Rights are just those rights that the founders respected as God-given. And so they put them in the Bill of Rights to protect the government from taking the right away from me. The argument against the Bill of Rights from people like Patrick Henry, for example, was that we shouldn't even enumerate those rights because then you're tampering with the whole idea that the government doesn't have a say one way or the other. So why even put it in the Bill of Rights? But some people said, no, we want it in stone. Well, when you're dealing with liberals, nothing's in stone because they're a bunch of liars. And they will redefine the terms. And when it says plain English that you have a right to bear arms, when it says in plain English that you have the right to assembly and to worship God as you see fit, when there is, all it says is Congress cannot pass a law establishing religion, which means they can't establish a church state. That's all that means. But you bring a liberal in and they will lie and they will deceive and they will turn that all into something it's not. And they will say that you have a right to bear a weapon to hunt. That's not what it says. And they will say that, oh, it's not just Congress not being able to establish a state church, but it's that we can't endorse religion. That means that we have to get prayer out of school, the Bible out of school. No, that's not what it meant. And the founders didn't believe that because they didn't practice that. They used tax money to buy Bibles and to put them in the schools.
The Northwest Ordinance
is another place. And the fact of the matter is that they actually held church services in Congress. There are examples over and over of the founding fathers using tax money to support what we would call a religious cause. What they never did was establish a state denomination. That's the only thing that means. And what my point is that you get back to, that you will find that people will totally twist things and turn them against you. And they'll say things like this, and you're breaking the law. Well, if it's going against God's law, then yes, amen, I'm breaking man's law. Don't go breaking man's law and just using God as an excuse. But when God's law is clear and man's law violates that, God's law trumps it. So how do we respond? How do we respond when people come to Jesus and they say, he's beside himself? They come to you and say, you're crazy. This is dangerous. It's too expensive. You're breaking the law. Well, this is from the original Greek here. Tell them to butt out. Amen. Hey, if you don't like what I'm doing, God's called me to do this. I'm just asking you to step aside and get out of my way. You don't have to endorse it. You don't have to pay for it. But please move aside. Yes. Oh, it's French. Okay. Boute out.
Pardon my French.
Pardon my French.
Yeah.
Because here's the question. Who do you serve? You serve that person who's questioning you? It's, say it's your mom, your dad, your aunt, your uncle, grandparents, brother, sister, best friend, whatever. Is that who you serve, or do you serve the Lord? Because once we are certain of God's will, we cannot allow anyone, in all caps, no matter how well-intentioned, from hindering our obedience. Now we come back to the question, are you sure God's called you to do that? You better be sure about that. But if you're sure God has called you to do that, then you don't let anyone get in your way. Anyone, anything. In the meantime, back at the house with Jesus and his friends who say he's crazy, this is what we find. While his friends were undermining him in the house, calling him crazy, his enemies were outside attacking him and calling him devil-possessed. You see, we'll just say this, like either in the house as far as the church you attend, or in the house that you live in, or in your household of friends or whatever, you'll have those attacks. But rest assured, as soon as you step outside the house, the enemies are going to be ready to attack you. And look what happens. Verse 22, read that with me. And the scribes which came down from Jerusalem said, he hath Beelzebub, and by the prince of the devils casteth he out devils. Wow. So he's got friends, so-called, saying he's crazy, and his enemies are accusing him of having a devil. He's devil-oppressed or devil-possessed. Either way, they're claiming that he's full of the devil. Well, we're going to see an example here of Jesus responding. And there, most of the time, you'll hear Jesus simply say things like, "It is written." But there are those who either don't care what the Bible says, or they know and they're just so twisted in their thinking that quoting the Bible doesn't get you anywhere because of that. The Bible says that the Word of God only works effectually in those who believe it. Mm-hmm. So when you're standing there talking to an atheist or someone like that, you can't just quote Scripture if you want to get anywhere with them. You have to first use some reasonable explanation or defense of your position, like Jesus is about to. He uses what we call deductive reasoning and simple logic to answer this ridiculous charge that he's got a devil. Now, that's biblical. Isaiah, in the first part of chapter 1, verse 18, he says, "Come now, let us reason together, saith the Lord." Why? Because Isaiah was dealing with people who knew the Torah, but they were unreasonable. Well, that's what Jesus is going to deal with here. He's healing people. Okay? But they're accusing him of having a devil or being devil possessed. So Jesus turns around and says, he called them unto him. He's picking a fight. That Jesus, he's always picking fights. Says, "And he called them unto him and said unto them in parables, how can Satan cast out Satan?" See, it makes no sense. "And if a kingdom be divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand." So here's Jesus casting out devils, but he's supposed to be doing it in the power of the devil. Makes no sense. Jesus is giving them a very reasonable response. He says in verse 25 and 26, "And if a house be divided against itself, that house cannot stand. And if Satan rise up against himself and be divided, he cannot stand, but hath an end." Doesn't that make sense? So he's responding by just pointing out how nonsensical their whole claim is, and then he puts the icing on the cake. Read verse 27 with me. "No man can enter into a strong man's house and spoil his goods except he will first bind the strong man, and then he will spoil his house." Jesus is saying, I'm not doing this in the power of the devil, and the only way I could do this is if I have bound the devil. And so Jesus is using a reasonable basis of logic to refute the claim that he's got a devil. Now, I have news for you folks. Some of you have shared with me that you've been told this, but do you realize that there have been people charging those who believe the King James Bible as being a cult? Mm-hmm. Others have actually accused some who teach this of being demon-possessed. But in the 70s and 80s, there were some men who were making that accusation, and now they've all changed and said, now they wave the King James around and say, this is the Word of God. Well, praise God. I'm glad they saw the light and repented. This has been going on, though. I'm going to be recommending this book to all of you and everybody on the internet and everything. It's called The Word, God Will Keep It by Joey Faust. He shows what we've been telling you for several years now. Christians have always believed that the King James Bible was the infallible Word of God. And they rejected the new versions based on that Vatican text up until the 60s. And they have been making this claim against Christians. I couldn't find all of the quotes, but here's one. This is in 1925. This was in a Canadian newspaper called the Lethbridge Herald. It says, quote, "There is the reader utterly indifferent, and there is the one to whom any departure from the King James Version is unpardonable sacrilege." That's us. "It seems clear to me that some admirers go past reason to an almost fanatical worship of the King James translation, end quote. In this book, going all the way back to 1611, over and over, they couldn't actually show error in the King James Bible. They couldn't refute that the new versions were coming from the Vatican. So what did they stoop to? Accusing you of having a devil and being an idol worshiper. That's what they did. And they've done it for 400 years. Now, those churches have gone to hell. The United Methodist Church, quote after quote of United Methodist ministers attacking the King James Bible in the early 20th century. The United Methodist Church now openly embraces evolution, abortion, and is set to begin holding gay marriages in their churches. That's hell. Yes. The Presbyterian Church USA already has gays in the pulpit. They fund abortion. They don't just support it, they fund it. The Presbyterian ELCA, it's different from the Missouri Synod, but the ELCA Lutherans openly promote homosexuality in their churches. Same thing's true in the Congregationalist churches. But if you read their history, it all started when they denounced the King James Bible and embraced the Vatican Bible. And once you do that, you don't believe in any Bible.
Amen.
That's the bottom line. You don't believe any Bible. You pick and choose what you want to believe, when you want to believe it. That's right. A God made up in man's image. So this was self-defeating logic for them to claim that Jesus had a devil. It's beyond ridiculous to say that Satan was empowering Jesus so he could defeat himself using Jesus. It just doesn't make sense. But, as I said, there's an epidemic of unreasonableness. Don't be caught up in the unreasonableness. Just a reminder of 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 1 and 2. Read that with me. Finally, brethren, pray for us that the word of the Lord may have free course and be glorified even as it is with you, and that we may be delivered from unreasonable and wicked men, for all men have not faith. That's the prayer for all of us here today. You feel led to serve the Lord and go in ministry, we pray that the word of the Lord may have free course, that you will not be hindered, that the word of the Lord may be glorified. Not you, but the word of the Lord, and that you're not hindered in your ministry, and that you would be delivered from unreasonable wicked men. Notice that last phrase though, for all men have not faith. There are a lot of people who will tell you they're believers, but they have not faith. We call ourselves Bible Believers Fellowship. Our website is kjvbiblebelievers.com. Why? It's the word of the Lord that we're about. We want people to be people of the book. And that starts with the gospel. Every ministry has a purpose in the spreading of the gospel. That's what's wrong with some of these ministries that feed the hungry and clothe the naked and give the homeless shelter and don't preach the gospel. That's not a Bible ministry. But if you do preach the gospel and you don't the other, that's wrong too. Bible ministry is to do what needs to be done for the purpose of the gospel and the glory of the word of the Lord. When you feed somebody, you can tell them how that Christ died for their sins, that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to Scripture. Be sure to visit our website at kjvbiblebelievers.com, where you can find a wealth of MP3 audio message downloads, along with additional videos, articles, and links. This message is brought to you by Bible Believers Fellowship, P.O. Box 662, Worthington, Ohio, 43085. I am Greg Miller. Thank you for listening.